What's up, scroll dudes? It's Nerp here, and you're watching my POV of the ESL All-Stars Highlander Cup 2014. So, this is not your traditional ultimate Highlander. It's not with every scroll in the game. What Highlander is, if you don't know, is where you only have a maximum of one of a certain card in a deck. So that most decks you see there, you have three of this, three of that, three of this, two of this. You only allowed to have one. So most people would like to do Ultimate Highlander, which is where you have like the 304 cards in the game and the deck is 304 scrolls. But because not everybody has a full playset, I guess the ESL Highlander is like this. So this is the last cup of the All-Star Tournament. And believe it or not, I actually won this whole cup, and that gave me a second place on the standings for all five ESL All-Stars tournaments. So that clinched me a ESL Avatar head, and I should be getting that shortly. I came in second in all the cups behind Antirad, with I got 15 points or something. So basically, there's only 13 people in this particular tournament. It's the last one, I guess. It had less people because less people were in the running for the Avatar heads. It's really only if you played them with previous ones you'll have a chance. And so here I was, only 13 people, and since I was the 2 seed behind Antirad, I I was seeded into the quarterfinals. So I had a buy into the quarterfinals, and the quarterfinals best of 3, semis best of 3, finals best of 5. So this is the quarterfinals. Atmaz already won his match in the round of 16. So he had to win to get here. I just got to buy into this match. So we were playing a best of three here. Basically, let me talk about the deck I chose. So I chose to make a Decay deck because I think Decay has overall the most powerful creatures and doesn't require too much synergy between them. Like, I didn't really want to do energy because like it revolves around Bombard and there's only one Bombard in the deck. It's kind of like that. You want like a lot of decent scrolls because you can't have any multiple copies. So I chose Decay, and I decided, you know, maybe I can pull off some like Puppet Soldier, Horn of Ages stuff. So I splashed in a few, like four order scrolls, plus Blessing of Haste, Focus, Aging Knight, and Horn of Ages, and a Puppet Soldier. I didn't actually use any of the order stuff besides Aging Knight a couple times, and Horn of Ages actually helped with the Puppet Soldier. But we'll get to that. So I faced... So I'm not going to show you this deck, mainly because I accidentally deleted it after the tournament, but it's really not a big deal. You can kind of guess. I basically went through the Decay deck, all the Decay scrolls, and just put in the best scrolls, and then took out a couple of them, put in some order stuff. That's basically all it was. And here in the first, in the quarters, I met up with Atmaz. So Atmaz seems to be playing a similar deck to me besides no order, just Decay. So it's Decay versus Decay mirror match. And the reason this video is so long, I have it going on like really fast. I'm not even sure like the multiplier of how much faster the playback is. Like, look how fast that clock's going. But it's because these matches took so long because like you don't have like all the cards to win. It's very draw dependent and it developed really slowly. And me and Atmaz both took very long times on our turns. So did the rest of the matches in this tournament. Because it was very a lot of work on the mind here, these close matches, and I think all the matches in this tournament for me were really, really intense. It was a ton of fun, but I was a little scrolls brain dead for this tournament because the Poi Poi Chen live stream was the night before, and I was like watching almost the entire thing, the 24 hours almost. I had to stream a bunch, so But I was able to win this. I was very surprised. Of all the All-Star tournaments, this would probably be the one I would least expect myself to win, because I don't think I'm very creative with like a Highlander deck. But yeah, so this is actually my first ESL that I won. I have placed in like countless others, lost in the finals, like a bunch of others won. First win. So faced Atmaz in the quarterfinals. I beat him 2-0, so I won this match and the one after this. I beat... Who is next? It was Dracula, Dr. Acula. He's Dragoner also, and like ESL stuff. I beat him in the semifinals 2-1. You'll see that was a little close, too close for comfort there, and I did a huge misplay in the first game of that series. And then in the finals, I actually swept the finals versus King Bob 3-0. And the little thing about the finals, I actually changed my deck. The whole way through I used this deck besides the finals. I knew King Bob was using energy, and I didn't think that was a good matchup, so I quickly cobbled together a growth deck for this, just one of every good growth scroll, and I was able to beat him 3-0 with that. So that was pretty good. And now, enough of that talking, I guess. It's time to talk about the game. So a big part of these games, which is really annoying for me, was me and Atmez, and you also see that it also happens in me and Dracula's matches. We always had Mire curses, and then the other person's brother, they always had a lot of things around either a witch doctor, a rot eater, or a scavenger construct. And those Mire curses really screw you up. They're so annoying to play around. And that was like terrible. I hated playing around those Mire curses. That was partially what made these games so long. They were draw dependent because luck was involved a lot with the draws. But I think it was very difficult. It was very hard for me to like know what to do in these matches. I think I played well in all the matches but the first match in the semis versus Dracula. That was the only match I lost. I played well in all the other ones, I think. But I did get struck by some lag in that one. Some tough lag. So here we are. I'm going to probably win the game. I have my Mire Curse Witch Doctor trying to keep it away from stuff. I'm able to pull Blightseed off, which really helps. And it's really just, at this point in the match, it looks like I'm going to win, like, rather easily. He kind of blocked up down there with a Watcher in front and a Scavenger Construct down there. And so I'm feeling good about this game. And then I only have to win one of the next two to move on. As you know, I won the first one of the next two. So here I do have Puppet Soldier, Ripper, Damning Curse. It's probably going to be the Damning Curse that helps me win. But then I draw a Hex Marks from the Blightseed and stuff. So that's just a win right there. And that is the first one match. So you see, each of these matches are really long. And hopping in. So, oh yeah, by the way, this deck that you're seeing me play right now, I made like 5 minutes before the tournament started. I just put it together. So it's not like long thought, like I didn't really prepare for this tournament as much as I do for the other ones. Like I usually have a couple of practice matches, but this one, nope, went right into it and I was able to win. So maybe I should do that more often because I always get knocked out in like the semifinals or the finals, like in all the tournaments. So this time I thought I had a good starting hand because I got a Harvester out and Eager Scryer and Bogcan, but Atmaz had a turn one Mire Shambler, which is the worst. So annoying. And he has a whatever you call it. I don't think the Blade Husk was in my deck. Which is very strange. You think I would have it in the deck, but I didn't see it show up, so I just made this deck really fast, and maybe I probably just skipped over by accident. But here I am, I sacrificed the focus and now I like my position on the board, now that I have that Harvester out and more units than him. Also, his turn, like, a couple seconds ago with that Restless Bones was interesting. I wouldn't agree with that. I see a Mire Curse, so I'm definitely going to hold on to that. And you see, I put down that Scavenger Construct. Hope I can draw an Animavore. And really, what just goes on it is Atmaz's Mire Curse. But, as you know, I'm able to win, but it got a little messy. So here I am. I'm hanging on. He has to resort down there. And the Mire Curse really helps here because I'm able to destroy that attacking Blade Husk behind and kill the Pest Assimilator. The Pest Assimilator is really, really hard to deal with. Well, not hard to deal with, but it's really dangerous if you let it live. And there's the Mire Curse. Which is, I mean, I'm happy he showed it now and put it down, and didn't have, like, anything to curse the other guys too, because now I could just move my Harvester away and stuff. So here, I'm feeling still good besides your Curse Monger. But I'm definitely not out of the woods because he does have a Lifestealer and a Rot Eater that are both pretty big. And I'm looking at, I have a Necrogen that could possibly be a quick win for me. I could also make my Scavenger Construct really huge. Here I get an Infectious Blight. And that was also a big key in these matchups. Not necessarily that the Infectious Blight took a big toll of the other person's field. It's more that when you got an Infectious Blight on your side, you really spent a lot of time trying to get rid of it. Like, not time, but you spent a lot of scrolls to get rid of it, so that was pretty worth it. And I get a Horn of Ages. I'm not sure if I had the Puppet Soldier yet before this or after this, so I'm not sure if I held on to the Horn of Ages. What was nice, too, about the Order Decay Splash, about the Order Splash in the Decay deck, was that I never actually had to sacrifice directly for Order. I always got the Order from the whatever it's called, the creature in Decay that gives Order when it dies. And another scroll that's just played on the screen was Draining Mist. That played a big key in these Decay versus Decay Highlander matches as well. Because Decay does not have a lot of counter reductions. All I had was one Blessing of Haste in the deck. And, it hurt me a lot, hurt him a lot. I had an epic Draining Mist versus Dracula. You'll see it later. And then, Draining Mist, but not as good. Sickening Fumes is also played frequently, but Sickening Fumes is not nearly as annoying as Draining Mist, but they're both pretty effective because they really slow things down, and that's why these matches took so long. Also so heavy on the brains that you took so long during the match. You could just see, like being fast forward this, you could still notice how long the turns took. There's a Sickening Fumes. Now I'm not looking as good, but I do have I'm able to, even though he's taking a few, excuse me, I'm able to have a pretty good turn here because I have a Brain Lice and I have a Maswell on the field. So I'm able to destroy everything but that. But now he's a huge Harvester. But I definitely have the board control. He does have an Idle Down. And Decay's Dominion for Idles Down is not too good. It does help the Nuru Flesh Seamstress because then you get the undead creatures have +2 attack. And then there's the Blade Husk. But Blade Husk usually doesn't get to attack. But what I noticed that got played pretty well with the Dominion was Malevolent Gaze a couple times during the tournament. I'm not sure if it was Atmaz or Dracula, where I would have something poisoned, like a really important creature, but I thought it would live because he didn't have any curse. He already used like his Bloodline Taint or Cluster X or something like that. But then he goes ahead and he already has an Idle Down. He puts down a Malevolent Gaze, and the Malevolent Gaze has changed on the test server. But on the live server, it gives you, curse 10 or something. So that it really hurts. So there, I got the win. Amaz thought he could actually pull it out there because he was starting to gain more board control with his Witch Doctor, but I had a Necrogen Hex Marks, which gave me the win there to destroy 10 health idol, a 5 health idol, and a 2 health idol. So here, I get a very good starting board control here. I get a Bog Hound and a Rod here. It does get the Blinguid, which is a little annoying. Oh, so this is, I didn't mention, this is the semifinals now. So I beat Atmaz 2-0 in the quarterfinals. And in case you missed me saying it, I didn't have to play in a round of 16 because I had I was the 2 seed. And here I have Oblivion Seeker for next turn, or if he has a 2 health or less threat, I could always Soul Seal, so I'm really happy at that. And I immediately sacrifice the Monstrosity because I'd much rather keep a Soul Seal Man, even though he doesn't have anything on the board that's a real threat right now. I still want it. Also, that Stitcher is pretty fun to have. I like that Stitcher on my side of the board. I figure I can do a lot of cool stuff with him. Can get rid of Blight, can buff my creatures, and a lot of people think of Decay as you shouldn't really buff your creatures that much versus Decay because they have Damning Curse, they could just get rid of it all in one hit. But we gotta remember, this is basically high on issue. I know Dracula, I'm sure he was Dr. Acula, because you see it's capital A, but, or Durgonor, because that's his name in ESL, he only has one Damning Curse in the deck, so I'm not too afraid of buffing my units, and, like it used to be energy was like that because of bounce specials, but now like you could just like Oak Blood and make his magic armor too, and he needs like two VDs to get rid of it. But now it's pretty close here because Doctor, I'll just call him Dracula. He has it's probably what's intended because it's probably like a play on words. That's why it's Doctor Dracula. But yeah, so he gets a harvester out and he's a curse monger up there. I'm getting worried now. This is he probably has a little bit of advantage here. This is the first time I've really been a little bit behind, I think, and I'm feeling and it's really a lot about the middle row too in these matches and these mirror matches, kind of mirror matches. And he gets a damning curse, so now he moves down. So I am a little worried here. I do get a new Flesh Seamstress. I'm not sure if I'm going to get a chance to use up a whole turn and put that down. His Harvester's at 3 countdown. I'm just going to try to hold myself on the bottom, get my own Harvester down, so if my units are dying, I could always try to come back with that Harvester. And he does get the Sickening Fumes. Like I said, it's a very big part of the match. And I'm just hoping that he doesn't have certain cards in his hand to come back. But I do have the card advantage on him, mainly because I think he was like really playing like multiple creatures per turn. Looking like last turn he played like 3 scrolls. I'm more of like a one big creature per turn so far, and I'm able to get a Corpus Collector out. And oh yeah, by the way, quick note: the matches you're seeing are in 720p maximum, I think, because I recorded them. I was playing on my laptop, which I like to record only in 720p because it lags out a little bit if I record in 1080p. But when I'm recording on my desktop, my game PC, I record in 1080. So here I am, I get a Witch Doctor, which is really awesome. But as you know, if you put a Witch Doctor down, it's just a Mire Curse target for your opponent, which is really surprising because there's only one Mire Curse in each of our decks, but we always have it for when there's like a Witch Doctor on the board or something, or when there's like a Scavenger Contract right in the middle of the board. And you see here, he got a Mire Curse Cluster Hex on me. Or Blood Lens, I'm not sure what that was. And that completely, like, that hurts me a lot. Look, my Harvester died. He has a huge Harvester going off. But look what I drew. I drew a Horn of Ages. Now I think I can come back in the game here. He got a nice turn, but I think I'm going to have an even better one. Because I'm tempted to kill the Witch Doctor and the Darkling in front. But I realize I just have to kill the Harvester back there. So the Puppet Soldier is going to do some work. Destroy 3 creatures. He does, he's able to put some poison on me, get an Infectious Blight around. So this is the match I said that I actually make some mistakes. Not yet, but, and also there's a bunch of lag that I said I wasn't able to do much. That's a problem with when I'm playing on my laptop too, because my laptop is on a Wi-Fi, connection. And, my computer's on Wi-Fi also, but, I mean, like, I sometimes doesn't connect that well from my bedroom, but, so it may, like, lag a little bit. But when I'm playing on my desktop, I have a wired connection to the wall, so it's, like, ultra fast. And here, he's getting board control. I have a Nuru, which is decent. Didn't do that much idle damage yet. I get my Sickening Fumes. I'm not sure if I'm going to get a chance to use it right now. I have Lightbearer, the other 3-2-3, whatever it's called. And I'm just going to play those. Don't want to play the Mire Shaman because I don't really have a good spot for it without getting, like, killed by Mire Curse and stuff. So I'm just fine with that. And he gets a Animavore, so now I'm really scared. If he gets like if he draws a Necrogun, that would help him so much. I'm not sure if he would use it because he'd give up his war control. But he would do so much idle damage, draw so many cards. And now I'm having so much things attack. I got a little unlucky with those two husks spawning down there. If they spawned up top, I could actually deal more damage. But luckily for me, I drew a Mire Curse, which is a big draw. So here I make some questionable decisions on choosing what to Nuru's Needle and what to Mire Curse. Maybe I should Mire Curse the Watcher. Maybe I should Mire Curse the Scamamore, but I did Mire Curse the Witch Doctor. And I think I should have probably Mire Curse the Scamamore. But definitely not the Watcher, because I've seen Mire Curse Watchers burn people before. Like, I remember an old match I played against, I think Rotspengel. I had, like, a double Watcher on the board, and he Mire Cursed it because Rotspengel was playing his, like, poison deck, which, I think he's known for playing the poison deck. And, like, I was playing Decay, and he double Mire Cursed there. I just kept on putting down creatures and just won in, like, 5 turns after that. You're surprised how much 2 idle damage every turn, like, at least adds up. So here, my board is almost cleared. It's not looking good for me. Not at all. And now I am just hoping. But then look, this is where I really mess up. Believe it or not, I'm just trying to like move my creatures, but it like won't let me. I'm trying to like I take a lot of time to think. I'm not gonna lie there, I take a lot of time to think, but then I'm trying to move now and it wouldn't let me move. That was a big problem. And I think I had lethal there. I'm not totally sure. I remember people in Twitch chat saying I had lethal, that I missed, and it's pretty devastating considering. Maybe I had lethal in the future in the match, but that was definitely that might have been a misplay, I think. But what I should have done there probably. Oh yeah, I don't think I missed lethal yet. In hindsight, I should have at least destroyed one of these idols so a blow Darkling would win, because I forgot I did not draw the one Darkling in the deck yet, so I'm gonna draw it next. It's the last card in my deck, a Darkling. And if I destroyed the other idol, I could just go Darkling Damage Curse or Darkling Necron, I would have won. So as you can see, I can't do that right now. And I just have to get units on the board so I can Necron, but heal all the stuff attacking. And it's really not looking too good. It's not looking too good. Also, the spectator, I remember, for this Purple Pansy screen got a little screwed up, so you couldn't really see what happened in the match. So I lost. People said I missed lethal. I kind of missed where I missed lethal, but whatever. It was poorly played. I waited till like the last 20 seconds of the turn to make the turn to make the play because I was spending time thinking. And by that when that happened, I had lag and I couldn't play stuff. So Dracula has a 1-0 lead on me in the semis, and I have to win the next two matches to advance to the finals. So at this point, I did already clinch a top four finish for the entire All-Star series. So I wouldn't be too bummed out if I lost, because I would still get the Avatar head. But still wanted to get my first ESL win. And I see I have a pretty strong hand with good creatures like the Oblivion Seeker and the Witch Doctor, but he was pretty fast out of the gate. And he gets rid of the Infectious Blight with the Grizzly Graph, something that I did earlier in the match, or maybe I did later in the match, I don't know. But you'll see that happen again, or maybe you saw it. Now I get the Witch Doctor out, so now it looks a little better for me. He does get the Pest Disseminator, which is pretty strong. As Poison has been played a huge role so far in the tournament. And like, these are just my matches. Like, most of the other Highlander matches that were going on from the tournament at this time were Decay versus Decay, so they were slow, but pretty exciting most of the time. Sometimes they're kind of boring. But you see, he took middle idol, so that kind of worries me here. And I made maybe a little questionable play here. Soul Steal that instead of the Darkling, so that's kind of interesting. And I was a little unlucky with the Mire Shambler spawning in a bad place like that. And you see that Mire Cursed Witch, I just wanted to die almost. Because it's just in my way. So he gets middle idol, and it looks like Dracula definitely has an advantage. He's a harvester behind he took middle idol, that's really important. He's a harvester behind Scavenger Construct, a Pest Stimulator, but I was able to renew the harvester, which is like pseudo removal almost like a second damage curse, which is awesome because you get the -1 move. I said a lot of people underrate Binding Root because of that. Like, Binding Root is one cost cheap removal, man. So here I'm trying to claw my way back. That new Rosine on the Harvester is pretty important. And soon I think I'm gonna get my Mire Curse on his Scavenger Construct, which would be really awesome. See, I get the Mire Curse here. And from there, I'm feeling much better. He is threatening me really hard on the top idols there, so I have to do something about that. So I'm thinking, should I Necro again? But I decide to wait off, because I can go with a Mire Curse this turn. But when I do that, like, he still has another turn to attack idols, and I'm getting a little worried. Actually, more than a little worried. So if he had and he's able to destroy my Curse Mire, so that was a little tough. And here, I think I just have to Necrogun. I'm able to Necrogun also with an Aging Knight, which is really awesome. So I can clear all his important stuff. So that's awesome. Actually, clear his board besides the Skinnamivore. Or I'm not even sure if that's Animivore on it. I think it does. I'm not sure. But it has Mire Curse, so I think that helps me more. And I sacrificed the Horn of Ages, and I see I have a new Reflesh Seamstress, which could make all my husks get 5 attack, which would be awesome. But I don't think I didn't want to play yet because, you know, I didn't want to play yet. At this point in the match, I think, like, I have the win, like, really easily. I mean, it does get a Nuru's Needle on there, so that kind of traps me in because there's, like, a zero-move guy there. But I wanted to keep the Blessing of Haste in case I could Blessing of Haste the Nuru next turn and possibly get a win. But I could have done it and would have had a chance to win, I think, but I don't think I took a chance. So now if you look at the board, I think it's pretty easy to see that I'm going to win this match. It's kind of looking bad for Dracula. He did do a very good job of holding me off the win for a while. It took me a bunch of turns to win. He just kept unblocking the idols pretty well. But I did win. I'm just putting on big creatures. I'm making sure he can't, like, get a Necrogen win or something. I am blocked in by that husk back there. That's Nuru's Needles. But oh well. I'm just cycling through my deck, trying to kill his creatures as they come up until I can get a opening for a win. And I'm keeping that Nuru down there so he doesn't sneak a win down there. I don't know. Probably doesn't have the right cards or resources to win if there's an open Tanoth idol. But just to be safe, I think it was good that I did that. And so I am just going along here. I get a Damning Curse. That could help me win really fast. And I think I may have missed Lethal a little bit earlier in this game also. But at this point, I don't think missing Lethal, like, here is nearly as bad as missing Lethal in the last game. Because in the last game, like, I ended up losing. But this game, if you miss Lethal for a turn or two, it's not a huge deal, but it's not like Dracula is gonna be able to win and capitalize on my miss. Because, like, just look at the board. That Sickening Teams is so annoying. But I am able to, because of the Nuru, they still have attack. So that's pretty cool. Most of them still have attack anyways. And,
Did I have Lethal here? No, but I was able to do a whole bunch of damage.
And honestly here, I could, like, try to Damning Curse myself next to the Watchers because he has pretty low health levels. I'd probably win the game, but it's not worth the risk because I'm going to win anyways. And I'm not sure what Dracula's trying to do here, just putting us all around the markers thing. But I think he knows he's not going to win here. But then he plays a Pillar of Fatigue, so that kind of annoys me. I actually made a little bit of a misplay. Not an important misplay, because, as you know, like, there's nothing I could have done almost to lose the match. But I thought I had Lethal on, like, a couple turns, but I forgot the Pillar of Fatigue was there, so a little embarrassing. I said GG before I had to. It's a little annoying when I did that. But, yeah, see, there you see Malevolent Gaze, what I was talking about. I was able to do that. And see, I said GG because I forgot that if I move the Sage, Viscera Sage up, it would increase in countdown. I forgot, and, like, I'm a little bit worried he can, like, do some crazy win here, but luckily I wasn't able to, so I could just win this turn with a Grizzly Graph, and that was pretty cool. So, yeah, I'm pretty happy about that win, and so now I'm still a little upset about losing the first game, because I don't think I played too well on that, and the lag kind of got me there at the end. But this third game, anything could happen versus Dracula. I got a turn one Scavenger Construct, and you think that's good, but I forgot that he is one Magikarp in the deck, and of course he's going to have it, and that's going to actually hurt me more than help me. But luckily, I think it does go down. So he gets a Commanding Star. I'm a little worried here, but my Soul Steal is really nice. So that kind of Soul Steal is such a good card. It's so much value. You get your own creature, you destroy his. It's just awesome. So I see I've, like, Decay's, like, three great 4-drops right now in my hand, which is awesome. Also, I guess you can include Hunter in that list. Elmire Hunter, I don't have that man. So he does get the Infectious Blight, which is annoying. And now my Curse Monger has it, so that will die soon, which is unfortunate, but I definitely have two pretty good units on the board, and he kind of has mess stuff, but there's a Rod here, which is pretty good. He gets 50-50 chance to, the 50-50 chance to, deal 3 damage to my, whatever it's called, my Pest Simulator, which he does, and then he had, of course, the Mire Curse to kill it. So that's clutch Mire Curse for him, because if that Pest Simulator survived, it would have poisoned his stuff, and he would have been sad. And now I'm a little worried, even though I have some strong units up top, it's going to die to Infectious Blight, and he has, see, he uses the Grizzly Graft to get rid of the Blight, and he has a Harvester on the board with three counts now, but I do damn and curse it. I know I lose two things on the board, but I actually lose something I wanted to lose in the, I actually lost three things on the board. The Cursed Army is going to die anyway, so I'm actually glad, because I got the order from the guy dying, and I destroyed the scavenger construct that had Mire Curse on it. So here, I'm climbing my way back now. I think that was a pretty good play. That Damning Curse kind of pulled it back towards me, a little bit more in my favor. But he's still a big threat, and I gotta protect that middle idol, or else that'd be bad. So now I'm getting much better threats on the board here, and now I'm feeling very good. That Damning Curse is a huge, huge thing. Draining Mist slows things down. But I think I'm all right, as long as he doesn't have a Damning Curse next turn to get rid of, like, the Witch Doctor and plow through. But I do play Heap Draining Mist, and yeah, Sickening Fume Sim. So that, he can't do anything there. Put a Watcher down there purely for defense. And maybe it could help out, so I put it in the middle there. But I don't want him to destroy that idol down there. He does get a New Rouge Needle, which, I mean, hurts a little bit, but I don't really mind that too much. And I'm putting down creatures. I did get, actually, the Baleful Witch helped a lot, because that his only threat on the board, really, was that Rot Eater, and he would have had Crazy Curse on it, so I was able to destroy it with that. He uses his Damning Curse on my Witch Doctor, which, I mean, it was bound to happen when he drew it, so that's okay, but I definitely have the advantage in the match. Look at all the stuff I have on the board. And I did actually also have a, I don't think I noticed when I said it, I was able to put a Searing Shackles on that Scavenger Construct, so I just have to destroy a couple idols. I have Hex Marks in hands, and it is looking pretty good for me. So if I didn't win this match right here, I would have been kicking myself. I would have been kicking myself because I had the win. I had so close to a win the first match of the series. But luckily, I was able to just forget about that first loss with the win here, and I just moved on to the finals. The finals, which is King Bob, and knowing that King Bob was playing energy, I thought Decay probably isn't going to be that good against it. As we know, Decay is not that good against energy. I mean, Decay is not good against structure energy, but Decay is okay against other energy because of the Soul Souls and stuff. But I only have one Soul Soul in the deck, so I do switch to Growth, cobble up the deck really fast, and he gets the turn one Dust Runner. So I'm like, oh no, there's only one Dust Runner in the deck. How could he have turn one Dust Runner? But it's okay. I have a decent hand. I do play the Brave. Normally against energy, I'd rather go with the Ranger than the Brave turn two because of Spark is a thing. But he didn't have it there. And no, he had a Storm Runner. That's like the best energy card. And he had it the third, round three. So I am so scared. And he had the Spark too. So that was really bad. But luckily, I had a Binding Root. I got a Binding Root. And that was pretty important. So now that Storm Runner is like, I could just move away from the spot he's lobbing to every other turn. But he does get stuff on the board now, and now it's a little bit scary. So here I'm looking at the board situation. I'm thinking I have Fertile Soil Quake as a backup plan. So I did Fertile Soil Quake. So I do regret putting the Ranger's Bane on that. But whatever. I did actually, it was okay because it actually stopped him from drawing. He would have gotten a hit in idle then, so it stopped him from gaining a card. So here I now have big card advantage versus advantage card advantage, but he does get nice health in front there with the mortar. And yeah, I'm not sure if this match or next match or the match after. A mortar that King Bob has. I don't know what he was like, who taught that mortar gunner, because he had incredible aim. But you see here, so I was able to quake, but now he's able to put a Canetta out, and I am toast. I'm thinking, how am I going to come back from this game? I was actually listening to Most of Purple Pansy's stream while I was playing, and don't jump at me saying I was like cheating, like trying to like know King Bob's like hands. Honestly, like, you kind of know exactly what's in the other person's deck because it's just probably the 50 best scrolls in the energy faction. There's really not that many good scrolls if you really dive into it. Like, when I was building the deck, it was kind of hard. There's some pretty bad scrolls in the deck. But, you get to use stuff you would never use for, and that hurts a lot. He had the redesign Machinated, which took me by surprise and almost clears my board. And now I'm thinking, oh man, I wish I had another Quake in the deck, but of course I'm not allowed to. And I wish I drew the Frost Scale there. Sadly, did not. I'm not going to try to draw Frost Scales. It's going to be a losing plan. I have to be really lucky to pull that off. So I do go with the Veteran. And I don't mind the Veteran because even though the potion resistance, I was able to take it down. But now he gets a State Machine out, and it's still looking better. I've played from behind a lot, a big part of this match. I actually played from behind in the next match and a little bit in the next match too. And I was able to come back. Like, Growth does a good job of coming back in matches. I didn't have to use Quake, I don't think, in the next couple of matches. But, yeah. Akio's Cannon, he does use a Magma Pack to get rid of that Elan Vital Breaker, which I guess is fine. I have a lot of scrolls now, so I have to start sacrificing resources. I'm trying to hold on to the Oak Blood, Untainted, and that other thing, Verdant Veil. Because if you have those, energy doesn't have a big way of dealing with it, because then they can't bounce dispersal, burn, spark, all that stuff on them. But they're not invincible. Like, they can still be brought down by combat damage. And here I have two great Relentless units. I have a Great Wolf, I have a Kinfolk Jarl, and you'll see. Relentless units, Great Wolf, Kinfolk Jarl, and Jarl Urhald have a big, big role in these three matches versus King Bob, where I swept him all three. King Bob played well, but I think I had pretty good draws for when I got my Relentless units. And I don't know, I think generally just Growth beats energy. Especially now with the change to Bounce Dispersal. So I don't think I actually saw Bounce Dispersal much in my matches versus King Bob, though. I get the Frost Scale now, much too late now. But now I'm able to claw my way back in the game, and I'm feeling pretty good about things. Because before, he had, like, all that stuff on the board night, and a Stormrunner, I had, like, nothing. And now I'm, like, doing well. And that is the first time that the epic Mortar Strikes nails my Jarl. But, I'm able to use the Frost Scale pretty well. I'm able to clear most of his board, the important stuff at least. And I'm able to just, like, sack my units like that, because I know he doesn't have no Thunder Surge, but he just used a Thunder Surge. And that's the cool thing about Highlander. You know there's only going to have, like, one Thunder Surge in the deck and stuff like that. So now I'm, like, pretty set in the game. As since he didn't have something to punish my Great Wolf there, I think I'm pretty good. I'm tempted to put the Verdant Veil on the Great Wolf, but I'd actually not even give it, it actually wouldn't even give it Ward, because Verdant Veil needs to have more health than it originally had. But yeah, you just saw the weekly winners there. During the tournament, I did lose my weekly winner to Arachnid. Is Arachnid 150? Oh, yeah, you just saw. Second, the Hellspawn Mortar Strikes again. Nails my Great Wolf. But that's how awesome this I was able to play with this Growth deck. I mean, I'm not how awesome I was able to play with it. Just how awesome, like, it was easy to come back with it. I lost a Jarl and a Great Wolf to that Mortar. And I'm still, like, easily taking this game. Look how, like, it looks like I'm going to easily take that with that Urhald that can't be Violent Dispersaled. Like, I am just, like, there's very little that he can do. Like, I do take a risk there moving down in case if he has, like, a bunch of Machinades and stuff like that, it's possibly he can kill my Jarl. But I take the chance. And, so it goes to show, like, even though that, like, everybody's, like, always just, like, Nerf Mortar, like, it's so RNG and annoying. Then it's really, that's because the reason it actually gets some kills now and then is because people don't bother killing it because they think it's not going to hurt them. But there's a 1 in 15 chance of it hitting any spot on the board, so I don't mind it. I'm hurt by it a lot, I do get some funny kills with it, but I'm not on the bandwagon of take out all the RNG in this game, because it's kind of fun, and a lot of good players like say, like, oh no, Hellspitter, like, RNG, like the good players aren't able to harness it, and really, like, it hurts, like it lets, I'm trying to say is, like, it doesn't involve much skill, but most of the luck elements in the game are manipulated by good players to give themselves a better chance to win. So there's always going to be luck, but it's really about the good players putting themselves in lucky situations. So that's just my two cents. Comment down below what you think about Hellspit or Mortar and overall RNG in the game. You don't have to agree with me, but yeah, so I'm about to win this match. King Bob is like probably pretty upset that I switched to, probably thought I was gonna be playing Decay and he might be able to win, but nope, I switched to the Growth. So that's the win, and now what was that? It was the first win. So the finals are best of five. So I have to win two of the next four matches to win. And here I'm popping in, and starting hand not so good. But now I've drew a new hand. This is like amazing starting hand. Look at this, almost perfect. If I only had a three drop, like an Earthworm Mystic. Oh, look, there it is. So this is like the perfect. That's like the perfect 2-3-4-5 for Growth. Those are the like the best 2-3-4-5 in Growth. But unfortunately, he had the spark for the Brave, so that didn't go to my way. But I'm still able to continue my curve. Charge Goal is kind of annoying. He does get a bunch of health in there with the Clock Library, but I'm still able to plow right in. And the second match, I wasn't really behind as much as I was the first match or the third match. But in all three matches, the middle of the match was closer. And this is actually a little hard for me to deal with because the potion resistance is very hard for Growth to deal with besides without Rumble. You saw first match, Rumble was huge. And huge, I got a very lucky Rumble play in the first match. But Untainted is a perk from a burn. And I could have Fertile Soil, but then I would just kill my other guy. So I didn't want to do that. And now, it does look like he can actually win. I sacrifice the Rumble here because I don't think I'm going to need it. I'll take... There's no point in me staying down there because the potion resistance is just... I can't deal with it. So I just move up. And I see a Metal Wonder. I don't think that's going to hurt me much. I'm not I don't need to play that much stuff. I could play a Quake right here. I'm not going to do that. Kills my guy. And I get a Great Wolf down. Now that there's no potion resistance down there, I know he can't even draw another one. I'm feeling very safe. And I top deck a Mangy Wolf, which is really, really, really good. That was a great top deck. Like, you gotta, every time you top deck something in Highlander, I mean, I know this is 50 card Highlander. 50 Soroll Highlander is, it's not that impressive to top deck something because it's one of 50 cards. But, I mean, like, one out of 304 cards is so much more impressive. But still, when you talk to him, you gotta realize that you're getting pretty lucky. Like, that Mage Wolf was pretty lucky. And now I'm feeling pretty good about the game. I would like to get a Verdant Veil or something on the Great Wolf so he can't Mount Dispersal it. And there's the Thunder Fish, which does kill my Earthborn Mystic, and it hurts me a lot. So now the game, it looks like it could go either way, but definitely looks like it is in my favor here. I'm able to get rid of the plating, get a Vetter down. I have a bunch of resources now, so it's looking pretty good for me, and a little bleak for King Bob. Looks like he's gonna go down 2-0 because it's only a matter of time before I move in with the top and bottom and crush him. But and here I'm getting the Jarl out, and even if I didn't have Verdant Veil on that Wolf, like, even if neither of them had it, if none of my big guys had any kind of ward, it would still be okay because he has one Violent Dispersal in the deck. And I can have a total of three huge threats, the Great Wolf, the Ur-Hals, and the regular Kinfolk Jarl. So, yeah, this is me just... I don't really mind cutting my units together either because I know he doesn't have a Thunder Surge because he already used it, and that was a nice draw by him. It was well played too. He was able to kill my Great Wolf, and that hurts a lot, but not enough to swing it back into his favor. So you see, like, last match there's a bunch of big Hellsporter hits. This match he was able to draw that great play, but still, like, I was ahead enough in the match to really just take it. I just took it, and I kept on rampaging through the game. But if he had a Violent Dispersal that last turn, it would have hurt me a good amount. And I do have a Jarl Ur-Hald. I do hold off on it, though, because all my stuff is attacking next turn almost, so then I can go with a Ur-Hald for, like, a Crimson Bolt thing. and I actually go with a Ranger's Bane on my own Jarl and an Earthen Testament so I can make an attack. I don't know about that play, but I really wanted to get rid of the 10 attack Relentless dude. So I don't really mind doing that. I am poison, but I could just win here with the pseudo Crimson Bull Urhald, so that was cool. The inspiring. And so now I'm up 2-0 in the series. If I win this match, I win. And with the entire ESL. So here I am. Not the best starting hand because I don't have a 3 drop and my 4 drops of Fertile Soil. But I did have a Mangy Great Wolf, so that was cool. But I do sacrifice the Mangy because the other souls I have in hand are better. Maybe a little mistake there. I sacrificed the Fertile Soil instead of the Ranger, but I don't know. You see here, like, this match, he definitely has the lead early on. Like, I have to come back. I had to come back in at least 2 of the 3 matches versus King Bob. But Growth was able to pull it off with big Relentless units that Energy can't deal with, only one Violent Dispersal. Oops, sorry about the little scuffling here. So here I sacrifice the Totem, and I'm thinking about what I want to do. It's just really, what I'm really thinking about is, do I want to put the Great Wolf on top or bottom? And I put it on bottom. I'm just going to want to sacrifice the Ranger up there, the Wetland Ranger. Wetland Ranger is an awesome card, but it wasn't really worth saving and possibly losing the Great Wolf too. And I hate using veterans where I don't get to utilize their haste well, but whatever, I didn't have another unit to play, so I just decided to play down there. And there I get the Verdant Veil on the Great Wolf, so that's where I first think, okay, I'm back in the game. He still has the Boar Control, but I also get the Binding Root, which we know is kind of like the removal. So definitely he does look to have the advantage. He puts down a Hired Marksman, and yeah. So it's looks to be better for me. He could have a spark. I think he does have a spark to deal with my Brave. Oh, man, my head's getting so annoyed. I've been talking, how long is this video? Like 50 minutes. I've got to take off these headphones. I keep forgetting that now I have a blue snowball microphone that just stands on the little like tripod thing on my desk. So I don't have to wear my headphones when I'm recording anymore. Because I used to have my mic on the headphones, but those kind of broke. So that's why I bought the blue snowball. And also, they made a weird buzzing sound in my videos. My head feels so much better now. You know that annoying feel when you wear them for so long? So he actually is able to destroy my Great Wolf with the Ember Bonds. And that's because the Verdant Veil does not protect you with Ward if you have less health than you originally had. Which, I mean, that's a little bit annoying. And he actually has a chance to, like, come back and win here if he has, like, perfect draws with Corrodes and Machinators and stuff like that and Bombards. But luckily he didn't, and I'm still feeling okay because I have both Jarls in my hand and an Untainted. So that's 2 epic units, and it's just beautiful. I sacrificed the Sister of the Fox because I want to get Jarl this turn, Jarl or Untainted on it next turn, and or both Jarls out, and it's looking pretty good. With that Jarl I just put out, I do have 2 idols down, so I have to watch out a little bit for him to like surprise kill me, because he does have a Graveblock Raider, and anything with Relentless on it like can destroy an idol with like 3 Machinators or something, and like a Desperation, so that would hurt a lot. It is only match 3 of the series, and I know I won the first 2 matches, so even if I lose here, I'd still have another 2 matches to win a game to win the series. But yeah, I move that Jarl up because I don't want, like I said, I don't want him to have like a Machinated a bunch and kill me. And I also move Owl there too. And like I said, still the same kind of point in the game where he's kind of holding on to survive. I also have another time in this game where I say GG before I actually have GG. I totally forgot that there was a 1 health idol down there. I thought I was destroyed for some reason. But here it's kind of a little awkward. he's just putting down stuff that's not really doing so. He kind of made a misplay there. He kind of messed that up. Like, I think he... I'm not sure what he could have done there if he was able to destroy the Jarl. I'm not sure. But, yeah. I'm able to almost destroy all his stuff here. And, untaint that so he can't, damage curse it. And it's looking pretty good. Almost out of breath here. Oh, I need to get some, like, water or something. So that Cabarato is a little annoying. I'm hoping I can get something to make my guys attack, but I get a rally, which is exactly what I need to actually win the game. And that gives me, is that the win? Oh no, is this when I think it's GG? Yeah, that's when I think it's GG. Sorry about that. I did it again when I was post-commentarying it. I thought it was GG, but I forgot there was a one health little down there. But, a road, maybe, I don't know, I could quake in a road, but that would clear most of my board also, so it's kind of stupid. The potion of resistance is really annoying. That cuts off the Urhald's pillage effect where he's able to attack every turn if he has an idol every turn. So, the potion of resistance is pretty effective, but like I said, it only holds me off a little bit. And, I'm able to win this turn. I'm thinking to myself, I'm able to win. Earthen Testament does make my guy attack, but so does God Hand. This is where I actually get the GG. So that is pretty awesome. And that is it. So thank you for watching. Hit that like button if you enjoyed. Subscribe if you want more content like this. And that'll be it. So make sure you leave a comment down below telling me your stance on the whole Elspeth or Mortar thing and RNG and scrolls, and I told you my take on it, so I'd like to hear from you guys, and I'll try to respond to your comments, have a nice little scrolls discussion. So, stay tuned for, I'm not sure if I can do daily videos anymore, I'll still have frequent videos though, and get ready for waypoints, guys.